If for whatever reason you have questions or concerns that you don't want recorded, that's totally fine. You are free to message me, to email me after this, and we can have conversations. We can have a conversation in this room once I turn off the recording. These recordings are posted on the CITL YouTube page, so they will be available to other people that are searching for this content. And so some people feel uncomfortable with that, and I totally understand. Sometimes you just need a few minutes to soak in the information before you ask the questions too. So if you have questions after this, that's totally fine. Happy to answer. Use reflection more effectively. I love that, Bethany. Again, I'm still trying to do that too, but I'm happy to share what I've learned so far. We're all in this boat together. So again, here's a little bit about me. I'm going to turn my a little video off so that you can focus on the slides. So again, I'm Dr. Lindsay Vreeland. Y'all can call me Lindsay. My pronouns are she, her, and I am the inclusive teaching coordinator for CITL. I'm one of the two inclusive teaching coordinators for CITL. So again, I'm coming from the English department, specifically from composition and from gender and sexuality studies, and really have been working with and struggling with reflections for 12 years now, as long as I've been teaching, and struggling with them as a student as well, in my career as an undergrad and a graduate student. So by the end of this workshop, we should be able to implement student reflection in our courses, recognize student reflections as a way to foster an inclusive and equitable class environment, create prompts that actively engage students in the reflection process, and create reflections to assess and address issues related to equity in the classroom. Again, this is not going to be I listened to this person for 50 minutes and now I fixed it. I'm perfect. But maybe this will be helpful when you look at your reflections again or think about how you might create reflections for your students in the future. I didn't say this earlier, but as questions or concerns pop up, feel free to put them in the chat. I will be looking at it as things go along, so let me know. There's going to be an opportunity at the end for you all to share things that have been working well for you, or ask more questions at that point too. So don't feel like you have to quietly wait for me to stop talking in order to get involved in the conversation. So studies show that students benefit from reflections. So they allow students to engage in critical thinking. They develop metacognitive skills. They're able to communicate their needs and identify personal growth and deepen their understanding about what's going on in class. And we're seeing this across the board when there are reflective assignments, even for K through 12, when students aren't necessarily able to write as well as our college students, if they're given reflective assignments, they're still able to reflect and to think a bit deeper about what was going on. And so we can do some simple prompts in order to encourage this, instead of just saying reflect. Reflect on assignment or reflect about today, asking students to ask themselves questions like, what should they do first? if there's anything confusing. Can they explain what they've learned in maybe that class that day, from the reading that you did, from the activity, from the assignment? Do they need extra help? And can they put into words what kind of help they need? If something's just confusing, they can identify that it's confusing, and that can lead to a conversation figuring out why it's confusing. If it was maybe like an exam or a quiz or something, if they got the answer for something wrong, do they know why that is? Do they know why they missed the mark on that particular question or requirement? Is the information applicable to other contexts? And how can they do better next time? And I'm not saying have them do these every day or every time they read something or every assignment, but these are some basic ways to start getting them to think about what they've learned, if they've learned, any questions that they have, and to really take their learning experience into their own hands. And courses are going to benefit from students writing reflections. It's not just the students themselves. And of course, if students are benefiting, you know, that then reflects back on the class environment, and, you know. But we can also harness reflections in order to see what students' needs are, what their perspectives are as far as like what's going on with the class. And then we can adjust content. We can revise assignments. We can give personal support based off of that. It also gives students like an outright chance across the board. Everybody, tell me what's going on. So they feel like their voices matter and they're empowered to actually ask for clarification or give suggestions. Some students that are afraid to raise their hand or are afraid that if they question the methods of their instructor or their professor, that there might be backlash. This gives them an opportunity to see that you are open to feedback and you care about their learning process. And again, it also demonstrates that learning is a process, and there's room for mistakes and recovery. It's not just a knowledge jump, and that you, as the person in front of the classroom, are going to make mistakes as well. Maybe you missed the mark with creating a specific assignment. Maybe there was a typo on an assignment sheet or on an exam or something that led to confusion. And so allowing them to acknowledge that that was confusing or that was frustrating also demonstrates to them that you're open to criticism, that you're open to acknowledging that mistakes have been made and that you want to recover from them as well. Depending on what kind of information you're getting or you want to get from reflections, you might not want students to disclose their identity. In classes in the past, I've gone back and forth between having anonymous reflections and identified reflections, depending on what the purpose is. So if you choose to do anonymous, students are given the opportunity to reflect on maybe the class, activities, content, or delivery, and they're able to give you an overall perception of what's going on with the course. And again, this provides them an opportunity to speak their mind without feeling like there's going to be kickback. I know that especially if you are teaching a gen ed And it's a requirement that the student takes this and so they can move on. There's a lot of fear about repercussions of speaking your mind because they just need to get through. But it also can be from students taking a class in their major. If you are part of that major, there might be concern that there's no future for them in that department, or they can't take the second class with you next semester. So if you give them an opportunity to anonymously say what's on their mind and take that into account, especially before end of semester evaluations, that can be really, really useful. You're able to gather suggestions and feedback from students on what might be improved, or again, further clarification. I really still don't understand what mitosis is. I don't understand the difference between institutional and systemic racism. So once that's identified, you can take the class back through that or provide additional resources for those that need to check up on that information more. It also gives you an opportunity to check in on students with simple questions like what's working, what's not working well, what would you recommend if there are current events going on that might impact students in the environment at class. This is a good way for you to just check in with them and see, hey, how's it going? Have you noticed XYZ things on campus? What would be helpful for class morale after this thing happened or during this thing? But if you ask students to identify themselves, you're also able to give individualized support for them. You're able to understand their progress as an individual. And you can also check in on the dynamics of groups or the class overall. So if you're doing group projects, if you do small group work, large group work, it also gives you an opportunity to make sure that everybody is doing okay. If you saw some strain, to make sure that things are going okay. I'm gonna mute myself real quick to cough. Sorry about that. Okay. So as I mentioned, we really want to make sure that we are designing our reflections with a purpose. So why are you using reflections? Are you using reflections because your department says you need to? Are you using reflections because it seems like a good idea, but don't really know, but just say reflect on this thing? Asking people to reflect is just such a broad thing. It's very vague and it means something different to everybody. So think about if you're trying to assess what their prior knowledge is or what their current understanding is of a topic. Are you trying to give them opportunities to reflect on and process new concepts and tasks, to think about a particular reading or a particular video that they watched in class to see what they gleaned from it? Are you trying to encourage students to think about and communicate their progress, their concerns, questions, challenges, or needs? And depending on what you're trying to get them to talk about, you might be giving them multiple, check-in reflections within an assignment or within a unit. So before something, during something, after new content or assignments or activities or readings and materials. If someone would have asked me to write a reflection before, during, and after reading Judith Butler, I think it might have helped me and the professor understand what I was getting and what I wasn't getting, and it would help me articulate why I felt like I wasn't getting something. Could have been really beneficial for those classes. That was a hard time for me. So when we're creating those reflection assignments, we want to make sure, again, that we really know what the purpose is. Is it something for you, or is it for them specifically? It might, you might both benefit from it. But if you want them to think about their skills and their growth and their knowledge base, then you want to make sure that they are really focusing on identifying what's happening internally with them, rather than giving you necessarily examples from class. And think about what you want students to think about specifically, or what questions you want them to answer. When you're asking them to reflect, give examples of reflections. You might go through one together, or you might write one and share it with them. Give them opportunities to practice and make it low pressure. If the reflections are low stakes or no stakes, so you get out of the 100 points for the semester, you get 1 point every time you turn in a reflection. Cool. You can still pass without turning in. Hypothetically, right? You don't have to turn in all of your reflections in order to pass the course or whatever. Maybe it's a daily or a weekly or monthly activity for the class. And so it's just understood that this is what we're going to do with this 15 minutes. And so they're more likely to actually complete them if you're doing them during class time and make it part of the schedule. Just like assignments, the more direction and understanding that students have, the more helpful their feedback will be, or the more that they'll understand what they are getting out of this too. And you can also tell them the purpose. I like doing that with all my assignments, but if you say, this reflection is for you, or this one's for me, which is why I'm asking XYZ things, it'll help them when they're actually going to work on that, to understand who the audience is, what the purpose is, and maybe how in depth or details or information is necessary. And I said this a little bit already, but make sure that there are regular practices so that students know that they're coming up. I teach writing, and students still get really, really nervous and concerned when they're asked to write in class if they don't know that they're supposed to do it ahead of time. So if that's going to be a regular thing, if you're going to have them write after every assignment, let them know, oh, hey, you turned in this on Friday, so on Monday we're going to write reflections, just to let them know, like, what's going on. Again, if it's every class, we're going to do a little reflection, or we're going to do this every unit, or whatever it looks like, make sure that you are keeping them filled in as to, like, what it is, what it's going to look like, how that's going to work for them. And you might just be doing reflections at the beginning of the semester to determine what their knowledge base is, midterms, and then at the end of the semester, totally fine. Just let them know that that's coming up and what kind of questions you're going to be asking. So as far as reflections go, there are different ways for us to do them. Some of us only teach online now, which is amazing for students that works best for them. But that means we're not necessarily getting handwritten reflections or handwritten work anymore, which is helpful for some students that don't like to handwrite, but also makes it feel like less low stakes for a lot of students. And there are different types of reflection activities that you might want to incorporate. So again, we can do virtual or handwritten. You might give them the opportunity to create like a voice memo and share that with you, or record a short video and share that with you. You could do reflections that are more like journals or stream of consciousness writing, or it could be in 3 sentences, answer this question. And so it's super succinct and direct. There are other ways for them to reflect depending on whether it's for you or for them. There might be use of words or images or symbols. And for some of our students that English isn't their first language, or for teaching classes that are language classes, you might ask them to reflect in the language that is their first language or their primary language, or in the language that is being taught. Again, is it for you? Is it for them? What's that purpose? So one of the activities that you might have students do is to write digital journals. So especially for those of us that are teaching online, it gives students an opportunity to create something, type in their notes, interact with texts and with class in a way that suits probably how they're already hopefully taking notes or working on assignments for the class. It also gives them the opportunity to put in graphs or images, embed videos or audio. They can use brainstorming tools. And so some of the prompts that might go along with that would be KWL. So having students identify what they know, what they want to know, and what they've learned. Or 3-2-1, where they identify 3 things that they found out, 2 things that they find interesting, and 1 thing that they don't understand. And both of these are really interesting because they give students the opportunity to take ownership over things that they actively do know. So it's not just like, I know you didn't understand what was going on. Tell me about all of your confusion. But it also gives them an opportunity to, again, like normalize asking questions or identifying what wasn't super clear. You might also have them write reflections in the form of like a social media post or video. So these would be probably succinct, like tweets. I know it's X now. I'm still having a hard time accepting that. So we'll call it Twitter for this for this presentation's purpose, but I do recognize that it has changed. Or if we're looking at Instagram posts, you might have them include pictures or GIFs or short form videos, but also have a little bit of either written content or audio to accompany that. So it's a good way for them to create a small snapshot of like what their impressions are, what they took away, what would they tell others about what happened in class or the content that they looked over, and how they connect ideas or themes by creating their own hashtags. So for students studying art or biology or something that might have a lot of particular images that would be helpful for them to navigate topics, looking at the structure of, the bones and muscle tissue in your forearm or something like that. They might create like a little pseudo Instagram post about that and explain what they learned, what they still need to learn, what they would share with their friends about that, something that they found were really interesting. And these aren't necessarily for students to actually share on their social media. It would just be creating something to share with you. So for a while, it was very, very popular to make students create social media posts so that you would have like a Facebook group that was for classes. I don't really believe that that's a good thing. But you can still have them mimic what a social media post would be like, especially for those students that are super familiar with social media. This might be an easy way to get them to transition into reflecting, and reflecting in short ways. And it might connect the dots for them that they're a lot of times doing it on their own, with the content that they're already sharing. Some of us might be familiar with exit tickets. Yes, Yellow Dig is super, super helpful when it comes to that. And in a space like Yellow Dig, you might have students all reflecting and sharing that with each other. What's the hashtag that you would associate with learning about this particular thing about a dung beetle or learning about this artist or whatever? Yeah, I love Yellow Dig. It's some people don't find it super intuitive, but I think that if you're consistently using it throughout the class, everybody will catch on. So another activity would be using exit tickets. These are becoming very popular in high school and middle school. So I think that people disregard them as being important or being like a useful activity, but a lot of stuff that we use in K-12 also applies to college. If it's a sound foundation, it's a sound foundation. So, having students write something quick about what did they find interesting in class? Why was it a hard class? What they understood, what's something that they don't understand, what's something that their instructor, their professor does not understand about maybe the content, the reading, what's going on with the student. If they have takeaways, what would be important in a few years down the line? So again, having them connect this to the larger context of maybe college or just like their career or personal life. How does it relate to something that they've learned before? What would you have, how would you have done things differently today? So if students are giving personal, are giving individual presentations, if they're working in small groups, if they're doing any sort of individualized learning, this is a good way for them to check in with you, whether you're in a physical class or an online class, and just get some quick check-ins as to how students are doing. And I know some of us teach a lot of students. So an exit ticket or even one of those social media posts might be more ideal for those of us that have over 50 students. It's a quick way to see what's going on. It's a quick way to see what some of the trends are with your students, and to make sure that they get a chance to think about how class went or how a reading went or how an assignment went. And again, exit tickets are pretty low key and can really help with virtual classes, especially when we know students are like physically signed in, but they're not interacting. Giving them a particular prompt to do an exit ticket. Okay, finish this exit ticket by 5 p.m. today. It encourages them to actually like pay attention and whatnot, but also just check in and see how everybody's doing. Square, triangle, and circle reflection is something I just recently learned about, and I was sharing it with another with a professor, and now she incorporates it in her classes and she loves it. Having students identify for the square, it's something that squares with their learning. So something that's reinforced by something that they already knew or believed. Having them use a triangle is to ask them to identify three key or important ideas. And a circle is something that they're still thinking about, something that's still circling in their mind. Either they're processing the information or they have questions or concerns about it. I think this is a really good activity to use when you are introducing new ideas, but also if you're having students do some readings on their own, this would be a great way for them to reflect on their readings and think about some of these big ideas. This would have really helped me in particular in like philosophy courses to identify like, okay, what did I actually take away from this? And you can do it so that students can choose one shape or that they have to do all of the shapes. And the professor that I was working with, she added her own shape, which was a heart. So she actually encouraged students to identify what they had personal connections to, something that, you know, they clicked with. In a way that isn't just like based off of their knowledge base. And you can add additional shapes too in order to encourage students to think about things differently. This is a good opportunity for students that maybe have like learning disabilities or even neurodiverse students who will be would easily gravitate towards looking at shapes instead of looking at huge blocks of text that are asking them questions. So this might be a good way for us to reinforce these ideas with other students or with students in ways that aren't just like throw these ideas at a paper. To actually like anchor them to shapes is helpful, and with dyslexic students too. Okay, so I'm curious, for those of you that are using reflection or want to use reflection, how are you using it already? How do you want to use it maybe? What problems have you encountered? And just generally, what questions do you have? Feel free to either type in the chat or turn on your mic.
I will just jump in since the first one's always the hardest one. I think I realized that I use reflection in every class. So I have them do an entry ticket, which I usually, it's kind of a way to get them focused on the material. You know, they're pretty busy and it allows them to spend 5 minutes kind of thinking about a question I ask. It also helps them build confidence in talking about it when we are discussing it. And then I oftentimes do an exit ticket similar to some of the ideas that you put there. So it's work. I didn't really think of those as reflections, but that's what they are. And I also have them write a reflection paper at the end of the course to help them think about how this is going to help them in their personal professional lives going forward, which I think is interesting to me for sure.
Yeah, I love that. So for their entry and exit, is the entry just like the beginning of the semester to like assess like knowledge base, or is it like
no, every class?
Okay, awesome.
Yeah, every class.
That's amazing. I love that. How do your students respond to that?
I think they actually, in the final reflection paper, oftentimes they talk about the fact that it helped build their confidence in speaking up in class because they had a chance to think about it before. It's not that I just ask that question right after after they're done with the entry ticket, but I certainly, it just builds their confidence. I mean, I think. And also, they're pretty busy. And so, just to sit for 5 minutes in silence and to think, sometimes I think they like that.
Yeah, I imagine they do. That's awesome. Thank you for sharing, Sarah. That's so cool. Me see. I use Yellow Dig for their clearest and muddiest point. Teaching in-person classes. I also have feedback folders where they can leave personal questions or comments. A physical folder, Stephanie. Or like an online space that they can drop things. Physical? Okay, cool. I've used exit tickets where they write one thing that they've learned stood out and what they still have questions about. Love that. I've started giving more choices and reflection options, like partner interviews, letter of advice to future students, and drawings. Those are all really great options. Advice to future students is something that I hear a lot of people using, but not necessarily, I don't think thinking through what that actually means for students and not giving necessarily enough direction sometimes. Because students end up saying, like, you need to show up to class, rather than like thinking through, which is like probably a good advice, but also thinking through like what the content is for the class, what skills they're walking away with, what challenges they had other than showing up to class. But I do think that that's something that can be useful, especially if you're sharing those past letters with your students at the beginning of the semester, of course, like anonymously, but saying, okay, this is what people have found to be true, and sort of like preparing them in that way. I think that like that's the full circle, right? And I think too, use these reflections, even if students identify themselves in them. If you're seeing multiple people are having the same question, or if one person has a question and it's a really good question, you can anonymously share it with everybody else, like, oh, people have this question. Let's go over this. Let's make sure that we're on track. Or this was confusing to somebody. Like, let's take a step back and go over this. And really demonstrating to them that like you're reading, you care, that you see that there is a need. You can also use it as a way to be like, a lot of people said that they feel comfortable, writing thesis statements now. That's amazing. I'm so excited that like you're feeling good about this, and as a way to encourage everybody too. It again is a good opportunity for you to identify outside sources that you need too. So maybe you don't have time to go back and cover something in great depth, but you can create a resource library for your students on Blackboard that helps support them in that learning. Yeah, if you're teaching grad students, I would say first year grad students and first year college stu undergrad students, excuse me, really, really benefit from knowing what advice other people have had for them. something that when I was in grad school, a lot of my peers kept on getting feedback of like, you're not able to do this at a graduate level, and they didn't understand like what that meant. And so having like feedback and having that information from other people would have been really, really helpful. Yeah, Sarah, go ahead.
Yeah, my question is a little bit, and I'm interested in other people's thoughts about this because I've used YellowDig and I do in my online courses, but sometimes there's a little bit of well, me too, you know, like there's, and that's not super helpful. And so I really like this idea of short videos that they would do kind of as an assignment to tell me that not everybody would see. But on the other hand, I think it's good if people can hear other people talk about topics and whatever. So it's kind of dealing with those. To me, those are kind of conflicting tensions. This, you know, students like me too, you know, like, oh, I agree with so and so. Like, that's not, I don't feel like they're really thinking. But on the other hand, it's good for them to share. So, does anybody who has used YellowDig have any thoughts about that?
That's a great point. I think one of the things is if you that sounds more of like discussion boardy stuff, which reflections can be used in a discussion board, but that sounds like a pretty common problem across like discussion boards. One of the things you can do is and I'm pretty sure YellowDig allows you to do this too, is that you can have specific spaces where students can't see other people's content until they create their own. So it wouldn't just be like regurgitating other people's ideas. Because what I've come across a lot too is that students, even if they're not trying to plagiarize, steal other people's ideas, if you read something and then are writing about it, you're going to be like regurgitating a lot of that language and a lot of that content. So that might be something to think about setting up as well. But I'm gonna let you. I'm gonna have one thought, Stephanie, and then I would love to hear from you. But something else that you might want to do is if you're thinking about having students write reflections, but also share part of that. They might write a longer reflection that's privately for you, but then share part of that reflection to the class so that you can see that they're actually doing all of that work, and all of that thought process on their own, but then they're able to share that, with everybody else. Yeah, Stephanie, go ahead.
You're muted, Stephanie.
I can't hear you, Stephanie. It says you're not muted, but the audio is not working. The convenience of an online workshop does not come without its challenges.
All right, any luck now?
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay. I again don't know, but my dog barked, so I'm glad you guys did not hear that. That's why I was muted and had my camera off. I just didn't want to type everything. So yes, I absolutely agree. I use YellowDig kind of as a discussion board reflection joint assignment. So their initial post needs to be more substantive in the sense that you have to tell me your clearest point, your muddiest point. It has to be at least 40 words. There are some some regulation so that that main post has some meat to it. But then they get much lesser points for the conversation they have with each other. So you're absolutely correct. People will say, oh, me too. I agree. So-and-so, whatever. But they still need to have that initial post, which gives me more of the information. I've used YellowDig actually since fall of 20. And the reason I got into it is I did one of those online teaching things during the middle of that summer of COVID, because I was having to go from fully online or fully in person to fully online, and I did not know what to do. We used it in that 3-week course with Siddle, and it really was nice. I like social media and the students like social media, so it's kind of like a nice version of it. So I did find, even going back in person, I still have used it to a lesser degree. But what I find is a lot of students, they do share, and you kind of mentioned this too, Lindsay, they do share that, you know, the muddiest point, their clearest point, especially the muddiest point when it is more of an online or an open forum, and somebody says, I really didn't understand this concept. And people are like, oh, me too, me too. It, number one, tells me that I didn't really explain it well enough, or maybe I need to add an additional video or something else to help the concept. But it also makes the students feel more like part of the group, like they're not the individual going, I don't get this, but why does everybody else? Because especially in nursing, we talk a lot about new things that they've never heard about and very complex issues. And I find that there's always a portion of the class that will be very limited in what they post, and they'll do a lot of the me too, I agree. But then there's probably, I would say, 75% that get more into it. And then you've got like 25% of your class that go above and beyond, and they're posting videos and memes or something else that helps solidify the content that the people are saying they don't understand. So it's kind of, I find that I view it as, like I said, half reflection, half discussion board. And some of the students, again, some students love it, and there's always a handful that hate it. But I've worked with it, but I do love the ideas that's been discussed here. So I'm going to probably start incorporating more things besides just YellowDig.
That's awesome, Stephanie. I'm also thinking about, like, so if you're using this combined space, which seems like very, it seems like it avoids like extra like busy work for students too, by putting all of this together in the space where they are reflecting, but they're having these discussions with one another. Making sure, because there's always going to be students that are just going to say like, oh, I had to comment on three people, I'm going to say me too, me too, me too. But making sure that they are really directed in the type of comments that they're giving one another. You have examples, you have things that they might ask each other, or you might encourage them. Again, maybe they can reply with a GIF or a meme or something like that, like in order to sort of like encourage them to interact a little bit more with each other, but also or redesign a meme to fit what's going on, to help somebody by finding the video, to encourage them to help each other and to engage in those conversations and really like process what other people are thinking. You know, like I love that your students are already doing that, Stephanie. That's mm-hmm. so cool.
And they do get additional points because it is, like I said, it is a point basis to it. For longer posts, for adding videos, for adding, you know, pictures, and then I can also go in as the owner of the space and add accolades, which are an additional point total. So again, there's, I would say probably 25% of the class every semester, I've got those above and beyonders who do extra stuff, and then they get rewarded point-wise, and everybody wants points for something. So it is, it does, the only thing I have to say about YellowDig is it's a lot of work on my end, going in, reading each post, commenting on it and stuff. But I personally, from my two graduate degrees, I'm going to think of a nicer way to say this. I despise discussion boards. To me, they're busy work, and it is a lot of very, depends on what you're asking. I've had some professors do very minimal and some professors do very elaborate posts, and it was just took forever. So I tried to find a way that I did combine that reflection with that discussion board piece in a fun method. That was my point.
No, I think that's a great point, because it also, yeah, other discussion boards tend to be very, very formal, tend to be restrictive, and don't build community. And so that's something that we have to think about too. What are, again, what's the purpose behind what we're doing? Are we making them write about this thing because they need to write about this thing, or are we making them write about this thing because it's benefiting them, it's benefiting the whole class? Like, what are the goals here? I wanted to see, I have my MBAs identify 3 to 5 things they want to remember from the class that represents what it means to be a good manager. Then they tie it to their own managerial identity. I love that too. That's such a, like, it's very practical, but it also forces students to think. They don't just slow down and think for whatever reason it is, right? It's always so go, go, go when you're getting your degree. Turn that off real quick. It is 10:59. I want to be so aware and mindful of your time. I appreciate you all coming today. I have final thoughts that I'll share with the email that I send out to you all at the end of this. I will also share information about Yellow Dig, since we talked about that today too. If you have any questions or concerns, please let me know. I'm so happy to answer questions. And like I said, I'll be emailing you all. So feel free to email me back, ask questions. Let's talk about this.